I decided that I wanted to talk about something else, which I've actually worked on, not the last 2 years, but the 2 years before that. The title is here. So if you want to hear more, if you want to hear more on superstring perturbation theory, I actually have written a series of papers. But the one you should look at first is the one with the same title as yesterday's lecture. Yesterday's lecture, even though it had the same title, didn't follow that paper at all. That paper is an overview of what I did in the 2 years that I worked on superstring perturbation theory. Most people would want to look at that paper first before going to the more detailed ones. Okay, but today we're going to go in a different direction. And I'll be talking about something called the Jones polynomial of a knot. It's a knot. So a knot is just a loop embedded in ordinary three-dimensional space. And the Jones polynomial is an invariant topological invariant of knots that was originally discovered by Jones around 1983. So many ways of describing the Jones polynomial were discovered just in a few years after Jones's work. They more or less all involve statistical mechanics or two-dimensional mathematical physics in one way or another. For example, Jones's original work involved what are called the temporally latent algebras of integral statistical mechanics. I don't want to assume you're all familiar with the Jones polynomial, so I'm going to just very briefly explain one of the original definitions. For brevity, the one I'll explain is the vertex model. So in the vertex model, the Jones polynomial is computed by a kind of discrete or finite version of statistical mechanics. This is a picture of a knot. And in traditional approaches to the Jones polynomial, one begins by projecting the knot to a plane. So we've projected it to a plane, namely the plane containing the screen. And we've projected it in such a way that there only are simple crossings. And so the height function has only simple local minima and maxima. No more higher order elements. Then we cut the knot into pieces by cutting it at each crossing, and also at each local maxima or local minima. So this particular knot, with that projection, would be cut into several dozen pieces, tens of pieces. And then we assign a variable, plus or minus one, to each piece. So we label each piece by plus or minus one, so this thing would have several dozen pieces. So there would be roughly 2 to the 30 possible labelings. And the Jones polynomial is computed as a sum over 2 to the 30 possible terms. We introduce a complex variable q, and we label. So if there's a crossing of two knots that looks like one of these pictures, for example here, the one from the left crosses over the one from the right, and all initial and final strands are labeled plus, we get a factor of q to the 1/4. With the same picture, but two pluses and two minuses, let's say here, instead of q to the 1/4, it's minus q to the minus 1/4. So these factors are a little bit mysterious, but it turns out that if we pick just these right mysterious factors, we eventually get a knot invariant. I actually haven't indicated here all the possible crossings, so the weights for the crossings are zero. Then for a local maximum or minimum, we again have zero except in these four cases, and in these four cases, we have the weight I've indicated where I is the square root of minus one. So the sum is a sort of finite version of the sums of statistical mechanics. And in the example of the knot that we started with, this one back here, there would be roughly 30 pieces, so 30 plus or minus 1, so we would sum over roughly 2 to the 30 terms, or these weights, or these weights, and eventually we'd get a Laurent polynomial q to the half, which is known as the Jones polynomial. Now, what's special about these particular weights is that the output of the finite sum does not So the Jones polynomial is a non-invariant. So it's a little mysterious that these particular weights lead to a not branch, but if you have a reason to suspect it's true, the proof isn't that long. You have to check a few elementary groups called the right amount of groups, and the checks are mysterious but short applications of these rules. Now, soon after Jones discovered his monomial, many other descriptions were found, which were involved a variety of methods, from statistical mechanics to two-dimensional conformal field theory. Among these, the ones that had most use for me was the work of Tsuchiya and Kanio on conformal field theory. One thing learned from this work was that, in general, a non-polynomial similar to that of Jones can be associated to any simple Lie group G and any choice of an irreducible representation R of G. So the original Jones polynomial is the case that the group G is SU2 and R is the two-dimensional representation. But there are analogous invariants, although definitions along the lines I gave at the beginning are even more complicated or harder to give. But they're analogous, no, sorry, they're more complicated. But they're analogous non-Jones for every representation of a simple Lie group. With these clues and also some advice from Michael Tia, I found in 1988 a description of the Jones polynomial in terms of three-dimensional gauge theory. So it kind of had the opposite drawbacks and disadvantages to other approaches. So the main advantage is that, as we'll see in a moment, if you're comfortable with quantum field theory, it gives manifestly an invariant. The other definitions are also a bit mysterious why they work. You have some recipe for what you do with the non-projection. It's not that hard usually to prove that the recipe works, but it's a little bit mysterious why it would be true. In the case of the vertex model, you have to write down these crazy weights. If you ever think of them, it's not that hard to prove it works. But where would they come from? And even more so for other representations. Here we'll have a manifest invariant, but the calculations are not so elementary. So the advantage is that why it works is more clear, but the disadvantage is that it's less obvious how you calculate it. So we start with a compact simple Lie group G, and to avoid minor details in this lecture, G is connected and simply connected. We also start with a G bundle, E over a three-manifold M, M is an oriented three-manifold. If G is connected and simply connected, E will be trivial, so we'll use the fact that it's trivial. Then we'll let A be a connection on the bundle E. Now, a connection, or as physicists call it, a gauge field, has its curvature, or Yang-Mills field strength, and if N were a Riemannian manifold, we could write down all kinds of gauge invariant local integrals of connection and its derivatives. For example, the usual Yang-Mills action is the square of the Yang-Mills field strength for curvature. All those invariants would be defined using a Riemannian metric on N. Here, since we're trying to make topological invariants, there won't be a Riemannian metric on N, and M will just be oriented three-manifold. With no structure except an orientation, there's only one gauge invariant function of A, or essentially only one, that we can write by integration of some local polynomial in A and its derivatives. This is the Chern-Simons function, which is defined by this little polynomial on the right. It was actually slightly hidden in yesterday's second lecture about flat connections. Now, I won't really explain the formula today. All we really need to know about the Chern-Simons function is that it's gauge invariant modulo 2 pi times an integer. But maybe, if there's a question, maybe other people want to know.
No. I'm intrigued.
So, if we're going to do quantum field theory, we need a Lagrangian or action. And this is the only candidate, because it's the only action we could write without a metric. But, okay, and then what Feynman would tell us to do was we take the exponential of I times the action, with a constant k, which would usually be 1 over h bar. And you divide by the volume of the gauge group. Actually, that's a main refinement due to Fadeev and Popov. And that integral is supposed to give us an invariant. The interval is over the whole infinite dimensional affine space U of gauge fields or connections. This is a basic construction in quantum field theory, though unfortunately unfamiliar from the mathematical point of view. Now, as I said, the Turing sinus function is only gauge invariant modulo 2 pi times an integer. But Feynman and Dirac told us that, well, we take the action multiplied by I and exponentiate. So the action has to be defined modulo 2 pi times an integer, which means that k here must be an integer. So what we define here is an invariant of a 3-manifold that depends on an integer k. And we might as well assume it's a positive integer, because a little plot will show that changing the sign of k is the same as reversing the orientation of m. So, formally, zk of m is defined with no structure of m except an orientation, so it's an invariant of the oriented 3-manifold m. So here and later, I'm going to ignore various details. I actually gave a lecture last week where I included a few details and I was told it was too complicated. So we're leaving out some details, but a typical example of a detail I won't explain is that n actually needs to be framed, which is something we learned if we follow the logic of the normalization theory. But later on, I'll try to skip this kind of detail. Now, a knot is an embedded oriented circle, k in m, and we want to include a knot, still using no information except m as a smooth oriented manifold. And the orientation won't help us because it gives no information at all when restricted to a neighborhood of a knot. So m is just a smooth manifold with an embedded circle. But we can think of the circle as being oriented. So what invariants can be defined? Well, if we pick an irreducible representation R, and that should have been a representation R of the group, G, not of the knot, k. Well, a gauge field or connection restricted to a circle has a homonomy around the circle, which actually, again, was important in lectures on flat connections. And we can take the trace of the homonomy in our favorite representation. Physicists write the homonomy this way, but anyway, the trace of the homonomy gives an invariant of a gauge field restricted to a knot. So in quantum field theory, this is called the Wilson-Loop operator. Wilson, of course, did not invent holonomy, which is a 19th century concept, but he was the first to do something important with it in quantum field theory. So the holonomy as an operator in quantum field theory is called the Wilson-Loop. So I think there's a lesson there, which is that I believe there's still an opportunity today to take a 19th century concept that hasn't been used in quantum field theory and get your name attached to it. So now we define a natural invariant of the pair m and k. We integrate over the space of all connections, the same thing we had before, times the homonomy, the Wilson-Loop operator. And this gives an invariant of a 3-manifold m with an embedded knot. It depends on an integer, little k, and a representation r. Sorry, we're going to hide them for the end framing through here. Now, if we specialize to the case that n is R3, and we take g to be SU2, and r to be the two-dimensional representation, then our quantum invariant becomes the Jones polynomial. Evaluated, remember the Jones polynomial depends on the variable q, we get the Jones polynomial at a specific value. So this expression for q in terms of the integer k has a close analog for any g, but I won't write it down except for SU2. So we only get a discrete set of values of q, but it's an infinite discrete set, and that's enough to uniquely determine a Laurent polynomial. So this formula for the Jones polynomial at this infinite set of values of k, or q, determines uniquely the Jones polynomial, assuming you know it's a Laurent polynomial in q. So the argument for this formula, that zk is the Jones polynomial at a special value, goes by making contact with conformal field theory via the work work of Tsuchiya and Kamen. So, to understand the Jones polynomial this way, we need a link between three-dimensional gauge theory and two-dimensional conformal field theory. And though I won't go in that direction today, I think I'll remark that this link is also important in condensed matter physics, in studies of quantum Hall effect and more modern phenomena like topological instants. So as I said already, this approach gives a definition of Jones polynomial of a knot with manifest three-dimensional symmetry, not relying on a projection to the plane, for example. But there were at least two things about it that many knot theorists did not like. Well, one was simply that the framework of integration over function spaces, although very familiar to physicists, is unfamiliar and not yet rigorous mathematically. Improving that situation is actually one of the Clay Millennium problems. And that's still true today, roughly a generation later, unfortunately. In fact, the rate at which this situation is improving has diminished. Because in 1988, there was still a relatively vigorous program in constructive field theory, although unfortunately it was starting to slow down. And definitely there's been less of that since 1988. Now, the second thing that caused many knot theorists to not like this approach is that it does not give a direct explanation of why the Jones polynomial is a polynomial. So the Jones polynomial is a Laurent polynomial in a complex variable Q, and from some points of view, that's so basic that it's part of the name, Jones polynomial. But here, we get an evaluation of the Jones polynomial at infinitely many values, which determines it, but doesn't give a very direct explanation of why it's a polynomial. So, more or less all other approaches to the Jones polynomial do not obviously give a topological invariant, but do obviously give a Laurent polynomial. For example, it was completely clear in the vertex model that that sum was going to be a Laurent polynomial, though it wasn't obvious that it was going to be a topological invariant. Now, there's a slight obstacle to getting past the fact that we only get an invariant that depends on an integer. And the obstacle is that for most three manifolds, the answer that comes from the gauge theory is the best one. Or at least that's what's believed to be the case. So, it's special to knots in R3 that the natural variable is not Q, but a complex variable, is not an integer K, but a complex variable Q. The quantum knot invariants on a generic three manifold M depend only on integer K. And as far as is known today, they do not have natural continuations to functions of Q without losing some of the three-dimensional symmetry. So the gauge theory gives what's believed to be, in a sense, the best answer. If you want an invariant that only depends on an oriented three-manifold M, maybe with an embedded knot, then the invariants that depend only on K are what we have. We don't think it generalizes. But for knots in R3, there is a generalization. And that generalization wasn't particularly clear in this explanation. So I believe 25 years ago I was willing to accept this state of affairs. So I was willing to accept the fact that there was some slight fuzziness about some details of string perturbation theory. But eventually it bothered me, so I worked on it for the last 2 years and told you a little bit yesterday. And likewise, I was willing to accept that the gauge theory gives a good picture on a general-oriented three manifold M, but isn't the best way to understand special things that happen for knots in R3. Anyway, I took 25 years ago, I took that answer at face value. But around 2000, around the year 2000, two developments gave clues that there should be another explanation. So one development was Kolmogorov homology, but I will leave that for tomorrow. The other development, which began at roughly the same time, was the volume conjecture, developed by the authors I've indicated, among others. And what I'll explain today started by trying to understand the volume conjecture. I'd like to stress, to avoid misunderstandings, I haven't succeeded in finding a quantum field theory reason for the volume conjecture, And if anything, I've become a little bit suspicious of whether it's true. But just to reformulate the Klein conjecture in terms of Feynman integrals, I had to learn a few things. And those things led to a new point of view on the Jones polynomial. So the purpose of today's lecture is to explain what happened to me when I tried to formulate the volume conjecture in terms of integration of gauge fields, and what new point of view on the Jones polynomial that suggested. Since I won't be aiming for a proof or even a physicist's explanation of the volume conjecture, I'll just give a hint or two about what it says. The volume conjecture will just be serving us as motivation, and most details about it won't be helpful. We want to navigate in a different direction. Now, for a first orientation, let's go back to our three manifold invariants, and let's ask how k is for large k. Well, the integrand is a complex number of modulus 1. Because it's the exponential of the square root of minus 1 times some integral. And when k is very large, the phase or argument is very, very rapidly oscillatory, except near critical points of the transcendence function. So the dominant contribution to such an integral for large k, this is one of the basic lessons of Feynman. It was Feynman's explanation of why classical mechanics is a small h bar limit of quantum mechanics. So Feynman had an integral like this one, and for a small h bar, which for us would be large k, the integral is dominated by stationary points of the action, but according to the principle of least action, stationary points of the action are solutions of the classical equations of motion. So by Feynman's principle, the large k asymptotics is going to come from the critical points of the transcendence function, if there are any. So this is an infinite dimensional version of a finite dimensional integral, like the one that defines the area function. So the area function is defined by this integral. It can be analytically continued, but we'll start for the moment assuming k and t are real. The integral isn't absolutely convergent, but it oscillates so wildly at infinity that it's conditionally convergent, with a result that's independent of essentially any way of defining it by taking the limit as the integration region goes to infinity. And the area integral has the property that if we take k to infinity for fixed k, which is analogous to taking k to infinity here, keeping everything else fixed, the integral vanishes exponentially due to rapid oscillations if there are no critical points on the real axis, which happens if t is positive. But it's asymptotically a sum of oscillatory contributions from real critical points, if there are any. A real critical point is just a critical point on the real axis. A critical point is a point at which the derivative of the phase vanishes for real x. Real x because we're integrating for real x. So the same logic, which is Feynman's logic, applies to the infinite dimensional for zk of m. In the case of the transcendence function, the critical points are flat connections. So if you the classical equation of motion is the Lagrange problem. Well, since the transcendence function was defined without a Riemannian metric, the classical equation of motion leads to has to also not involve a Riemannian metric. And the only equation you can write for a gauge field that doesn't use a metric is that the curvature or field strength vanishes. Anything else you can do will require a Riemannian metric. So the critical points are flat connections, which correspond to representations of the fundamental group into G. So the asymptotic behavior of Zk of m for large k is given by a sum of oscillatory contributions associated to such homomorphisms. This has actually been shown explicitly in examples, originally more than 20 years ago. So that's the story for a general three manifold where k has to be an integer, but we can take it to be a large integer. Now let's consider the case of knots in R3, so that k doesn't have to be an integer. let R be, in formulating the volume conjecture, we let R be the n-dimensional representation of SV2. In that case, the non-invariant is called the Culler-Jones monomy. Then we take k to infinity from non-integer values with fixed k over m. I've already told you what would happen if we take k to infinity through integer values, right? Loosely coupled. But it's important in the volume conjecture that we take k to infinity through non-integer values. A choice which is actually simple and very precise and illustrates the idea is to let k be shifted from integers by a fixed constant k0. We keep k0 fixed when n goes to infinity. So k over n is approaching 1 while k goes to infinity through non-integer values. It's shown now by computation. Well, how's the computation done? You take your favorite definition of the Culler-Jones polynomial through the vertex model or whatever else you like. You get an explicit formula for sub naught. Then, in that formula, you take large n with k of this form. It's usually expressed in terms of q rather than k. And the large n here is now a sum of contributions of complex critical points. By complex critical points, I mean simply the critical points of the analytic continuation of the function turn signs of A. What does analytic continuation mean? It means what it always means. We take real variables and turn them into complex variables and try to interpret the original function as the specialization to real variables of a holomorphic function. So in the case of Church-Lyman's, there's no problem doing it. First, we replace the gauge group with its complexification. For example, if G is SV2, then the complexification is SL2C. We replace the G bundle E by its complexification, but for our purposes, E is trivial and the complexification is also trivial. Then we replace the connection A on E by a complex connection, by a connection on EC, which you can think of as simply as complex value connection. So just naively, you take your gauge field to have complex components instead of real components. All that analytic information means, to be faster, is that you take all the real components of the gauge field and think of them as complex variables. And then the analytic continuation of term signs of A is given by the same formula, but now the components of A are regarded as complex fields, so I think of them as components of curl A. So the formula is the same, the only difference is that the variables are complex variables. That's all that analytic continuation means in this case. So, on a general 3-dimensional M, a critical point of the analytic continued term sinus function is simply a complex value flat connection corresponding to a homomorphism of the fundamental group, not to the compact group G, but now to its complexification G sub C. In the case of the volume conjecture for R3, the fundamental group is trivial. So what I just said here wouldn't give anything except zero. But we're supposed to also include a holonomy or Wilson loop operator in a big representation. So n is going to infinity together with k, and the consequence of that is that we have to consider the knot in citing what we mean by a critical point. And that's elementary, but with a little bit of a digression. So I won't give a full explanation, I'll just say the answer. The right notion of a complex critical point for the Culler-Jones polynomial is a homomorphism from the knot of the fundamental group of the knot complements. So R3 would have a trivial fundamental group, but if you remove the knot, it then has a non-trivial fundamental group. The flat connection is only a point away from the knot, and it has a conjugacy class of holonomy around K that depends on the ratio of n over k. So what's found in work on the volume conjecture is that typically the Culler-Jones polynomial for a large n with k of this form is governed by a complex critical point. Now, physicists know about various situations, such as tunneling across a barrier and reflection above a barrier, in which a finite path interval is dominated by a complex critical point. But ordinarily, these are complex critical points that make exponentially smaller contributions. That's a basic fact of life. Your physically sensible path intervals do have complex critical points, but their contributions are exponentially small near the classical limit, not exponentially big. What really puzzled me for quite a few years, actually, about the volume conjecture is that for many knots, the dominant complex critical point makes an exponentially large contribution. In other words, as I've told you at the beginning, well, this is a very important thing. If you take n to infinity, this should be k0 plus n, not k0 equals n. If you take n and k to infinity through integers, the Keller-Jones polynomial has oscillatory behavior, but it grows exponentially as soon as k0 is not an integer. Concretely, that happens because the Chern-Simons function evaluated at the relevant critical point has a negative imaginary part. So the exponential of ik times Chern-Simons grows exponentially. In real physics, what will always happen is that the complex critical point will have the right sign of the imaginary part of the action, so that the effects of the complex critical point are exponentially small. But obviously, this has an essential difference from real physics, because the contribution of the critical point is exponentially big. So I wanted to understand why that happened, especially since I knew it doesn't happen if k0 is an integer. Why does that happen as soon as, take, unfortunately this equal sign to be a plus sign, but take k to be n plus 3 is fundamentally different from n plus 3.1. Even though k and n are going to infinity. That seemed very funny, and it bothered me for a long time. But eventually I learned that the same thing can happen in an ordinary one-dimensional interval, such as the one I've written on the slide. So we're just integrating over a unit circle. The interval depends on two variables, k and n. They will play a similar role to the variables I called k and n in discussing the Keller-Jones polynomial. We've captured the idea that k has to be an integer. N doesn't have to be an integer, so it's not a perfect analog of the Keller-Jones polynomial, but it captures the important properties.
Is it rational?
Well, obviously you can see for yourself this interval makes sense for complex n. That interval converges for all n in the complex plane. But we will voluntarily think of n as an integer, constant. Or at least real. Well, actually, this is a much-studied integral because it's an integral representation of a solution of Bessel's equation as a function of n. The variable in Bessel's equation isn't usually called n. I'm just calling it n here because of the amount, because that's what we call the variable in studying the Jones polynomial. So, as I said, we think of k and n as analogs of the parameters that we call k and n in the gauge theory. Now, if we take k and n to infinity with a fixed real ratio, the integral has an oscillatory behavior for exactly the same reason as I told you for the area function and also for Chern functions. We're integrating a number of modulus 1 whose phase is k theta plus 2n sine theta. Its modulus is 1, and the phase is k theta plus 2n sine theta. So if k and n go to infinity through real values, say with a fixed ratio, well, if the function f has no critical points on the circle, then due to very rapid oscillations, this function will vanish faster than any power of 1 over k. It vanishes exponentially faster. If there are critical points, the integral has oscillatory behavior, dominated by contributions from the critical points. So this integral can either oscillate exponentially, can either oscillate for large k or vanish exponentially, depending on the ratio, the value of k over n when k goes to infinity. I'll let you, if you're interested, write down the equation for critical points and find the values of the ratio where there are critical points on the circle. To imitate the situation considered in the volume conjecture, we want to analytically continue away from integer values of k. And actually, you can find out how to do that on Wikipedia. We first set z equal e to the I theta. And then we think of our integral as an integral in the complex plane. And there we're integrating on the unit circle. And if you think of it as an integral on the unit circle, k should still be an integer. So obviously, the function you're integrating is only a periodic function on the circle if k is an integer. You could decide you don't care about periodicity and let k not be an integer, integrate from some point on the circle to itself. Bessel's equation wouldn't be obeyed. We here think of Bessel's equation as a baby version of all the so-called Warden entities, or Schrödinger estimate equations, of quantum physics. So in our analytic configuration, we want to preserve Bessel's equation. We can get away from integer values while still obeying Bessel's equation if, for example, the real part of n is positive, we switch to this integration contour. We don't just integrate on the real circle. We add tails that come in from minus infinity and go back to minus infinity in the z-plane. The real part of n being positive makes sure that the integrals of the tails converge. When you try to prove Bessel's equation, you have to integrate by parts. But there are no surface terms because they just vanish exponentially out here. So we now have a generalization of the original integral where k doesn't have to be an integer and Bessel's equation is still satisfied. So what's written there is what I just told you. But how does the integral behave when k and n go to infinity for fixed ratio? Well, the answer is it does the same thing the Collard-Jones polynomial does. If k is an integer and n is real, the large k behavior is oscillatory or exponentially damped, depending on the ratio of k over n, as I said before. But as soon as k is not an integer, the large k behavior can grow exponentially, just as for the Collard-Jones polynomial. Now, these statements are all elementary, but to prove them would take us a little bit too long. So I'm not going to actually give the proofs, which you can find in my paper. Well, they go back to the 19th century, but you can find my explanation in my paper on analytic configuration of translations. Rather than giving the proofs, I'll just explain the technique one uses to make the analysis, because it will show the technique we'll follow in taking a new look at the Jones polynomial. So we're trying to do an integral like this one, where f of z is a holomorphic function, and gamma is an integration cycle, possibly not compact, but at least it has the property that the integral in this cycle converges. Which basically means that the real part of the exponent goes to minus infinity at infinity along gamma. So in our example, f is this. But it's not quite perfect for the exponential I'll give because f is not a single value because of the logarithm. So it's better to work on a cover of the z-plane parameterized by w, which is log z, on which f is single value. And then in terms of w, we're trying to do this integral. F is now single value, which will be, which I'll assume in the explanation I'll give. So, we have a particular gamma in mind, and we want to know how the integral behaves on this gamma. But to answer such a question, it's helpful to first describe all possible cycles on which the desired integral converges, and then relate your particular contour to the general case. Moore's theory gives a description of all possible cycles on which the integral converges. We take the real part of the exponent. So we're doing this integral where the exponent is k times f, which is a holomorphic function. We take the real part of kf and call it a Morse function. This Morse function is important because it controls whether the integral converges. A good contour or cycle is one where h goes to minus infinity at infinity, ensuring that the integral converges. So the critical points of h are just the points where its derivative vanishes, but those are the same as the points where f, the derivatives of f vanish. So, for example, where f was this, the derivative of f is this thing on the right-hand side, and that's the equation for a critical point. So it's a quadratic equation for e to the w, so you can easily find find all the critical ones. The key step is now the following. To every kernel to point grout or P of H, you can find an integration cycle, gamma P, called a left-shift symbol, on which the integral converges. And moreover, Morse theory tells us that this gives a basis for all the integration cycles in which the interval would converge. To find gamma P, the picture is like this. So remember, our Morse function is the real part of the holomorphic function. But the real part of the holomorphic function does not have a local maximum or a local minimum. So any critical point is a saddle point. So I draw a saddle point. Well, if you're trying to find a cycle in which the interval would converge, you want H to go down, not up. So there's one direction where it goes down, and there's one direction where it goes up. So the direction where it goes down gives gamma P. And that's the left shift symbol. The answer, what you say, you need to find the gradient flow equation of Morse theory using any complete metric such as a flat one. And gamma P is a set of all points you can reach at time zero by great. We really will need this later when we have the term sign theory, so can't rush through. So the picture was this one, but we also will need these formulas. For the formulas, we first take a complete Taylor metric on the W plane. You might as well take the flat one. Then you introduce a new time coordinate, and you imagine somebody who's living on the W plane with instructions to move in the direction where H goes down as fast as possible. That means this person should obey the equation dw dt is minus the derivative of H. That equation will help you move toward negative in the direction where H diminishes as fast as possible. And the left shift symbol, gamma P, to define it, you can solve the flow equation on the integral from time minus infinity to zero, asking that the initial value is at P, and then gamma P consists of all points you could reach at time zero, starting from P at time minus infinity. So in the picture, well, there is a solution where you just hit at P for all times. And so P itself is in the left shift symbol. On the other hand, you could just be very slightly displaced in the downward direction in the forecast, and eventually you'll flow down here. But where you will be at time zero depends on just how much you were displaced at the beginning. So by properly adjusting the displacement at the beginning, you could be anywhere on gamma P at time zero. So gamma P is all points you could reach at time zero by gradient flow that it started at P at time minus infinity. And the integral, our integral will converge over gamma P, because although gamma P isn't compact, H goes to minus infinity at infinity along gamma P. Which means that the integral converges, and Morse theory will tell us that this is a basis of all cycles on which the integral converges. Furthermore, there's no problem to find the large chaos asymptotics of the integral over gamma P, because the absolute value of the integrand is the exponential of H. And by definition, H had a unique maximum on the cycle gamma P, namely at the point P. So for large K, the integral is approximately just the exponential of this value of P, the exponential of K times F of P. And then, if you're familiar with Gaussian and almost Gaussian integration, you can calculate the series that multiplies this. So the gamma P are bases of cycles with two properties, the integral converges and has simple asymptotics. Morse theory tells us that any other cycle in which the integral converges can be expressed in terms of left shift symbols as a sum of left shift symbols with integer coefficients. So now we have a framework to determine the asymptotics of the integral for gamma for any gamma on which it converges. We compute the integers a sub p, and the integral over gamma is dominated by the gamma p with the largest asymptotics such that a sub p is not zero. If you apply this to our integral, you learn what I said before. The integral has a qualitative behavior similar to that of the Clausius polynomial. The limit that n goes to infinity with k being a constant plus m has very different behavior depending on whether k naught is an integer. Concretely, if k naught is not an integer, the large k asymptotics is dominated by two Lefschetz symbols whose contributions cancel if k naught is an integer. Maybe I'll stop just for a moment for questions before we go back to the Cauley-Jones polynomial. To the Jones polynomial.
It's known that the cat's invariant is the other characteristic of two or more.
I'll take that later. That's a little too far. Okay. Any questions more on what I'm talking about? So hopefully it's fairly clear what we should do to understand the analytic continuation to non-integer k of the quantum invariants of knots in R3, and also to understand the asymptotic behavior of the Cauley-Jones polynomial that's studied in the volume conjecture. We should, first of all, replace the space U of real connections with the space curl U of complex valued connections, and we should define Lefschetz symbols in the space of complex valued connections, and we should replace the usual integral of gauge theory with the sum of integrals over Lefschetz symbols. However, it's probably not clear that this will actually lead to a useful new understanding of the Jones polynomial. It was certainly not clear to me at this point. In fact, in my first paper on this, I didn't. I answered the question stated here, but I didn't really. It became more useful later. So, to define the Lefschetz symbols we want, we have to consider a gradient flow equation on the infinite dimensional space U with complex valued connections, with the real part of the exponent of the path of the finite integral as a Morse function. Actually, because it might be more familiar, we'll practice with the case of gradient flow on the space of real connections, with the ordinary Morse function as a, with the ordinary transaminous function as a Morse function. This case is actually familiar to researchers on Donaldson and floor theories, so it might be familiar to some of you. So first, a Riemannian metric one for the K-metrical M induces a Riemannian metrical in the space of connections by this formula. And with this metric, we can define a gradient flow equation that's going to be a differential equation on a four-manifold. To do gradient flow, we introduce a new time variable. So we already had three dimensions. Now we'll be flowing a three-dimensional connection as a function of time. So flowing a three-dimensional connection of time is going to build up fields that depend on four variables. So the flow equation will be a differential equation on a four-manifold. It can be concretely written like this, where the essential fact is that the variation of transignments is the curvature, which is actually the reason that the critical points of transignments are flat connections, a fact that we discussed earlier. Now, a couple of miracles happen. This equation, a priori, has no reason to be elliptic, which basically means well-defined as a differential equation in Euclidean symmetry, or to have four-dimensional symmetry. In other words, we find it for a four-manifold of this special kind, and there's no general reason that it would make sense for more general formula. But both of those things happen. It turns out that this equation is a gauge-fixed version of the instanton equation f plus equals 0, which is an important equation in the physics of gauge theory and also in the math of gauge theory. It's an equation that's elliptic, modulo of the gauge group, and has full four-dimensional symmetry, meaning it's naturally defined on any oriented four-manifold, not necessarily of a product form associated to gradient form. So, even if you're not familiar with these miracles, they're kind of standard miracles, which we now, they're very well-known to researchers on Donaldson and floor theory, where they play an important role. So it turns out the same miracles happen for gradient flow in the space of complex connections, with the Morse functionality, the real part of complex transformations, and with the obvious Taylor metric. The gradient flow equation is again a gauged expression of an elliptic differential equation that has full four-dimensional symmetry. This equation is a sort of four-dimensional cousin of the celebrated equation of Hitchin in two dimensions. It's an equation for pair A and phi, where A is a connection on the G bundle, and phi is a one-form valued in the actual bundle. And the equation can be written this way. So I won't do anything with the formula. I just wanted to write it down to emphasize that it's a natural formula. We can write it any oriented formula. All we used was the Hodge star and the exterior derivative and the wedge problems.
But it breaks complexified gauge symmetry, right?
It doesn't. It's not invariant under complexified gauge symmetry. It's supposed to not be. Because remember, what we use it for is to define an integration cycle, which is a completely real cycle in the space of complex fields. In our example with the Bessel function, okay, we were discussing real cycles in the complex space. So if the equation had complex gauge symmetry, it would give a complex subnormal. We're trying to do the opposite. An integration cycle is completely real. It doesn't have any complex directions. So it not only breaks the complex gauge invariance because the Taylor metric wasn't the complex gauge invariance, and in a sense it breaks the complex gauge invariance as much as possible. Now, so a couple of unexpected things happened here, which is that the equations are elliptic equations with four-dimensional symmetry. But that much I realized in my first paper on this, but something else happens, which took longer to sink in. The equations we get are actually equations of Witten and Einstein in relating gauge theory to geometric landmines. And that turns out to be important for a reason I'll explain in a moment. I should say these equations have also been studied more recently by Taubes and by Gallardo and Wollman. So now that we've found the gradient flow equation for complex transignments, we can define a left example for any choice of a complex critical point. Remember, you take the analytic continuum function, to each of its critical points you attach a left symbol. The critical points are representations of the fundamental group in the complex loop, corresponding to complex flat connections, curly A's or grub, as we heard in two lectures, Monday and Tuesday. So we work on the four-dimensional x, which is m times r plus. R plus is the semi-infinite line in the time plane, time direction. And so I've drawn the picture here. Here's m, and here's r plus, which is characterized by the time. Time is 0 here, and it's minus infinity over here. And the thimble, gamma l, consists of all complex connections, a plus I phi, on n times time 0, which is the boundary. But our boundary values are solutions of the KW equations on n times r plus that approach a sub rho at infinity. So at time minus infinity, we start with the critical points. That's the complex flat connection a rho. Then by solving the KW equations, we engage in gradient flow. And the gradient flow ends at something over here. And the gamma rho parameterizes all those somethings. So for a general m, there are various choices of rho, and this leads to interesting issues that haven't yet been unraveled. But you see, there's something very special now about the knot 2 over 3. Even further, I want to emphasize that from the picture, the knot only will be in the number. It doesn't affect the gradient flow.
So what is wrong? Is it labeled with the connection? What is wrong?
Nothing is wrong.
No, what is wrong?
Rho is a complex flat connection associated to a representation of the fundamental. So the flow starts at time minus infinity with the critical points. And it flows to something. A middle dimensional space of some things, because now we're in many variables, in fact, infinite many variables. So the space of all some things that you can flow to is going to substitute for the space of real connections. It's infinite dimensional, just like the space of real connections. On a general end, there would be different choices of rho. And I'm sure there's a lot of interesting mathematical physics there that hasn't been unraveled. But we can see what's special about blobs in R3. Since the fundamental group R3 is trivial, any flat connection on R3 is gauge equivalent to the trivial one. And therefore, there's only one Lefschetz symbol, the Lefschetz symbol of the trivial flat connection. But since the Lefschetz symbols are a basis for all the integration cycles, there's only one possible integration cycle. And therefore, the usual integration cycle in the original gauge theory definition of the Jones formula is equivalent to the Lefschetz symbol. So instead of defining the Jones polynomial by integration over U, we can define it by integration over the Lefschetz symbol gamma naught. So here's our Jones polynomial. It's the integral over gamma naught. This should be colored equal. This is the analytic information of the naive integral. And instead of integrating over the space of real connections, we integrate over a Lefschetz symbol in the space of complex connections. Okay, there are a lot of things you can say about this, but I want to say just one or two things in 5 minutes.
If you put the wisdom loop, you're changing the function, right? So
well, that's actually a very good question. The question is whether we include the Wilson loop in the definition of Lefschetz symbol. So when I discussed the Collard-Jones polynomial, when k became large, m also became large. And then we do change the Lefschetz symbol. But here, we're going to do something else. We could do that. I don't want to. We can do something else where we keep m fixed while only k is large. So we define a Lefschetz symbol that only depends on k. So the Lefschetz symbol doesn't depend on the knot. But we include the knot as part of the integral we'll do. But if you wanted to know the ideology behind that, so it's the original Jones polynomial. You could think of k as being larger than n is 2.
Okay.
The original Jones polynomial is for the two-dimensional.
We can change it.
So there's another setup that makes sense, but they're both explained in my paper. But where the thimbles are defined in a way that depends on the knot. But we're going to use thimbles that are defined independent of the knot. And the knot will only be part of the functional integrator of the thimble. Any other questions? So in my work on composition, I studied a twisted version of n equals 4 supergradients in 4 dimensions. And the twisted theory localized on the space of solutions of the KW equations. So we did something completely different, which went towards geometric timelines. But in the present context, the space of solutions of the KW equations is the Lefschetz symbol we're supposed to integrate over to get the Jones polynomial. So the upshot is that the Jones polynomial for 9 and R3 can be computed from a path interval of n equals 4 supergradients theory on a format called R3 times R plus is a half line with a slightly unusual boundary condition. Boundary. R3 times R plus is a half space in 4 dimensions. So it has a boundary of R3 times 0. Well, here I've drawn it as a general M, but for the Jones polynomial, we'll take M to be R3. And instead of saying in words that we localize in the space of solutions of the KW equations, we can say, well, we do N equals 4 supergradients theory in a twisted version that localizes on the space of solutions of KW equations. So we've expressed the Jones polynomial in terms of 4-dimensional gauge theory instead of 3-dimensional gauge theory. It's a slightly mysterious answer, but one more step brings us into a more accessible world. And that last step also gives a new explanation of why the Jones polynomial is a Laurent polynomial in Q. The step in question was also key in my work with Kapustin, and more generally, in much of the work of physicists on N=4 supernovas. This is electric magnetic duality, which is the four-dimensional analog of mirror symmetry in two dimensions. N=4 supernovas with gauge group J is equivalent to the same theory in which the gauge group is the length of G and R dual of G, and with the coupling parameter being inverted. Now, to apply this to our problem, we have to know what happens to the boundary condition at R3 times 0 under electric magnetic duality. Most mathematicians working with mirrors probably realize this, but that, the analog of that question is the basic question in mirror symmetry. What's the object in the higher categories of mirror to a given coherent sheaf? That's a question about how the duality acts on a given boundary condition. So we need, in this special case, the four-dimensional analog of that question to learn anything concrete about our problem. Luckily, for the precise boundary condition that's relevant here, the dual was described by Garrett and Bain a few years ago. It's somewhat unusual, and I'll describe it tomorrow. All I'll say today is that this boundary condition is similar to a standard local elliptic boundary condition and has the effect of reducing to finite dimensional spaces of solutions of the KW equations. In this situation, after making the duality transformation, the moduli space of solutions has expected dimension 0, and we just have to count the number of solutions Bn for a given value n of the second term class. As usual, Donaldson theory, the count is made in signs. The boundary conditions depend on the amount k and the choice of the representation of R which is labeled. So some details on that tomorrow. The only way that the knot enters after the electric and magnetic duality transformation is that the boundary condition that we use in the counting depends on the number. Given the knot, we count the number of solutions. And then the path interval local relation tells us that the path interval is the sum over n of q to the n times the number of solutions. This exhibits the Jones polynomial and the related quantum invariants of knots in three dimensions as Laurent polynomials in Q with integer coefficients. I put the words Laurent polynomials in quotes because the powers of Q are shifted slightly from integers in a way that depends on the representations. But essentially, it's a Laurent polynomial in Q. Thank you, and we'll continue tomorrow with Cohen. Any other questions?